Hello students, welcome to the new topic of class 12 Pole Science Arts, and today we will start with ASEAN, that means Association of Southeast Asian Nations, and it's from chapter number 3, New Centers of Power. Clear? So take a look at the political map of the world. Which countries would you say fall in the southeastern region of Asia? Clear? So regarding this topic, we need first to look at the world map, by which we will clearly understand what does ASEAN stands for. Now regarding the world map, you can see that Indonesia is here. This is southeastern part. So Indonesia, Singapore, Malaysia. Clear? So this part can be figured out as the southeastern part. Clear? So before and during the Second World War, this region of Asia suffered the economic and political consequences of the repeated colonialism. Means whatever the countries we have looked in the world map, that is world map political, whatever the countries we have gone through, they have suffered what? They have suffered economic and both political consequences. Economically also they collapsed, and politically also they collapsed. During what? Repeated colonialism. That means repeated, they were being attacked and annexed, both European and Japanese. At the end of the war, it confronted problems of nation building, the ravages of poverty and economic backwardness, and the pressure to align with one great power or another during the Cold War. So starting from, you can see they have suffered what? Economic collapse, political collapse. After that, after the end of the war, what happened? It confronted problems of nation building. Now they have collapsed in such a way that they were even not able to survive. They were again trying to build themselves from zero. So they had problems of nation building, the ravages of poverty. Poverty also had captured them so much due to economic collapse and economic backwardness and the pressure. After that, after so many things, there was one pressure, which was what? During the Cold War, they had two allies. They were being pressurized to be with one of the allies during the Cold War, that is the Western Alliance or the Eastern Alliance. This was a recipe for conflict, which the countries of Southeast Asia could ill afford. Clear? So this was what? The area of conflict. If they don't abide by them, they will be attacked or they will be captured. And on the other hand, the Southeast Asian countries could not fight war also with those superpowers. So the problem was existing by both the ends. Efforts at Asian and Third World unity, such as the Bandung Conference and the Non-Aligned Movement, were ineffective in establishing conventions for informal cooperation and interaction. So in order to solve these problems, that means what? They wanted to set up their own nation, and in this process they wanted to do it by themselves only. Regarding their whatever the collapse had happened earlier, they were trying to revive by themselves, but there was a pressure to be what? To be aligning with one of the two superpowers. This was the, so whatever these problems were, they tried to sort it out. But efforts at Asian and Third World unity, that means Third World unity means whatever the developing countries are numbered as what? Third World. So in that also, such as Bandung Conference and the Non-Aligned Movement, that means these are the, this was the conference and this was NAM, as we read earlier. So with the help of these also, it was what? It was ineffective in establishing conventions for informal cooperation and interaction. That means the Bandung Conference also and the Non-Aligned Movement also was not successful in bringing back the peace and harmony of the Southeast Asian regions. Clear? The southeastern region of Asia. So these two institutions also were helpless in bringing back the peace in that particular countries. Clear? Hence, the Southeast Asian alternative countries alternative by establishing the Association of Southeast Asian Nations. Clear? What they had thought then when Bandung Conference and the NAM was helpless, or you can say that it was not successful in bringing back the peace, then what happened? They established the Southeast Asian countries, themselves established what? Association of Southeast Asian Nations. That means ASEAN. Clear? After that, as they established this ASEAN was established in 1967 by 5 countries of this region. That means Southeast region. This was established in 1967. Remember the date. And this was done by 5 countries of this region, namely Indonesia, as we have seen in the world map, Indonesia, Malaysia, the Philippines, Singapore and Thailand, by signing the Bangkok Declaration. This is one of the most important part of ASEAN. That means what? When it was established? It was established in the year 1967. By how many countries? By 5 countries. And what were the name of the 5 countries? Namely, of that region only, particularly Southeast Asian region. And that country's name were Indonesia, Malaysia, the Philippines, Singapore and Thailand, by signing the Bangkok Declaration. So this was the declaration, they signed it and they formed this ASEAN in 1967. Clear? The objectives of ASEAN were primarily to accelerate economic growth and through that social progress and cultural development. Clear? Their motive was behind establishing ASEAN was clear. First and foremost was the economic growth in that particular in the Southeast Asian region. So for with that vision they formed this ASEAN. So the first objective was to accelerate economic growth. Whatever the economy of these countries had collapsed, they were there. The first and foremost duty they did was to accelerate. That means on the track they were trying to bring this economy of the particular countries related to ASEAN. And along with that, social progress and cultural development was also seen. So objective, you can write it here in this way, that first objective was to accelerate economic growth. After that, along with economic growth, they were also aiming at what? Social progress, means the progress of the society as a whole. And along with that, cultural development should also go in that rapid way. So you can say that there were 3 objectives related to the formation of ASEAN. A secondary objective was to promote regional peace and stability based on the rule of law and the principles of United Nations Charter. So you can say that 5 overall objectives were there. First was economic growth, second was social progress, third was cultural development, and along with that, the fourth one was to promote regional peace and stability. That means 4. Overall 4 you can count. The fourth one was to promote regional peace and stability based on the rule of law and principles of the United Nations Charter. So whatever the rules they will bring in order to promote this regional peace and stability, they will abide by the rule, law and principles of what? United Nations Charter. Clear? Over the years, Brunei Darussalam, Vietnam, Laos PDR, Myanmar, that is Burma, and Cambodia joined ASEAN, taking its strength to 10. So earlier it was how many countries? It was 5. So after these 5 countries, that means Indonesia, Malaysia, the Philippines, Singapore and Thailand, 5 more countries joined them. So the sixth number country was Brunei Darussalam, then 7th was Vietnam, then number 8 was Laos PDR, number 9 was Myanmar, that is Burma, and number 10 was Cambodia. They also joined what? ASEAN. So its member strength was now how much? 10. Clear? After that, Unlike the European Union, there is a little desire in ASEAN for supranational structures and institutions. ASEAN countries have celebrated what has become known as the ASEAN way, a form of interaction that is informal, non-confrontationist, and cooperative. The respect for national sovereignty is critical to the functioning of ASEAN. So what it is written, unlike the European Union, as we have read earlier, in the European Union what there was? There was their flag, their currency, clear? But they didn't have constitution. Like that only, there is a little desire. That means ASEAN had some objectives regarding the economic growth, but they were not aiming to be like the European Union. They had a little desire in becoming like them. So, ASEAN countries have celebrated what has become known as the ASEAN way. So, ASEAN, actually, when they meet, that meeting and that whatever the conference is being held between the member countries, whatever the 10 countries are there, so whatever they are doing, they are naming this meeting as the ASEAN way. So a question might come that what do you mean by ASEAN way? It is actually what? It is actually the meetings, conferences, celebrations that the member countries of ASEAN do, which is known as ASEAN way. In other words, it can also be written as it is also a form of interaction. That means interaction between these 10 countries, it is a form of interaction that is informal. That means it is not formal. It is casual. That is non-confrontationist. It cannot confront the other country. It cannot uphold the other countries in regard to any issue. And cooperative. That means what? It's very easy and casual. Their meetings are the form of interaction or meetings that they held are very informal, are very non-confrontationist and very cooperative among each other. The respect for national sovereignty is critical to the functioning of ASEAN, and moreover they are not interfering in any country's national sovereignty. They are not here to insult any country's national sovereignty. So this as a whole is known as the ASEAN way. You can write that it's the celebration, it's the meeting, it's the conference, which they called it as ASEAN way. And in other words, it is what? It is a form of interaction. That is how the meeting conferences are actually. Number one, it is informal. Number two, it is non-confrontationist. And number three, it is very cooperative. And last but not the least, they also give respect to the national sovereignty of each and every member countries of ASEAN. So this as a whole is known as ASEAN way. Clear? With some of the fastest growing economies in the world, ASEAN broadened its objectives beyond the economic and social spheres. Clear? Earlier, what was the objective? Well, they formed the ASEAN in 1967. The motive was economic growth and social growth. But after that, with some of the fastest growing, they had seen that other organizations are also there which are fast developing and they are going to bit fast. So with that aim, it also broadened its objectives. That means what? Apart from economic and social spheres development, they had broadened. They were motivated to broaden their objectives. That means apart from these two, they were trying to make the objectives even more elaborate. So in 2003, ASEAN moved along the path of European Union by agreeing to establish an ASEAN community comprising three pillars, namely the ASEAN Security Community, the ASEAN Economic Community, and the ASEAN Sociocultural Community. Clear? Unlike, you can see here that they were at first not interested in the foothold of European Union. That means what? They were not interested to become like another European Union. But as all the other organizations, or you can take the examples of European Union, how they were actually accelerating from an economic hub to the political one, with that given respect, they were the ASEAN were also motivated to be the same like European Union. So in 2003, as the primary objectives of there was firstly what? Economic and social. But they had what? They had broadened. That means they were moving on to become another powerful organizations like the EU. So believing in their foothold, what they did in 2003, ASEAN moved along the path of European Union by agreeing to establish an ASEAN community comprising three pillars. That means first that was ASEAN. Now they were aiming to make this ASEAN as ASEAN community, in which three organizations will be there. That means subdivided into three organizations that will look after the security part. One, the first pillar will look after the security part, second will look after the economic part, and the third will look after the socio and cultural part. So like this, in 2003 they named ASEAN, and the ASEAN was again elaborated, again subdivided into ASEAN community, under which three pillars were named. And the first pillar's name was ASEAN Security Community, looking after security of the ASEAN member countries. Then second was the economic, which was named as ASEAN Economic Community, and the third one was named as the ASEAN Socio-Cultural Community. Clear? So try to remember this. This is an important part. Firstly, the ASEAN way, you have to know it in a good way. After that, you have to know this also. What were the three pillars of ASEAN known as? That means you will tell what? The three pillars of ASEAN were namely what? The security community, economic community, and socio-cultural community. So moving ahead, here you can see this is the ASEAN flag. Clear? This is in picture, and here is a circle. So what is that actually? Let us read. In the Asian logo, the 10 stalks of paddy rice represent the 10 Southeast Asian countries, bound together in friendship and solidarity. The circle symbolizes the unity of ASEAN. And from where this picture is taken actually, the source is www.aseansec.org. So what is this? These are the 10 stalks of paddy, that means rice, which represents what? 10 is equal to 10 member countries. Clear? Starting from Indonesia to Cambodia. And this represents what? These 10 represent 10 member countries, and along with that it also represents their friendship and solidarity. Clear? Unity and friendship. And this circle under which these 10 paddy rice stalks of paddy rice are there, this circle symbolizes the unity. That means what? Under one circle only these 10 member countries are there. This represents what? Unity. Clear? So I will wind up today's topic here only, but before winding up, let us revise once more that we have learned to know about ASEAN, when it was formed. It's the year 1967. Primarily first 5 countries were there. After that, these another five countries joined ASEAN. Clear? After that, they celebrated their meetings, which was very informal and non-confrontationist and cooperative also. They named this holding of meetings as ASEAN way. Clear? After that, we came to know about, like, other economies, when they compared themselves with other biggest organizations, they also followed their foothold. After that, in 2003, they established ASEAN community. After ASEAN community was established, under which three pillars were made actually, subdivided into three. And these three pillars would look after the security part, the economic part, and the socio-cultural part. Clear? Then last but not the least, we came to know about this, the flag of ASEAN actually, what it is in the circle, what does the circle represents, what does this symbol represents, everything. So with this, I hope that whatever the points we studied today, it's now very much clear regarding ASEAN. In the next class, we will continue with the same topic. As the topic is vast, we will continue with some other interesting facts about ASEAN. So with this, I'm winding up today's topic. Thank you.